गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरु साक्षात् परब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। द प्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ द साइंटिफिक truth is always in a coded language, and those who do not know the codes, they are reading English but not physics. Physics is the subject and the medium of instruction is English. So if somebody is able to read English, that doesn't mean he knows physics. In the same manner, because we are able to read Sanskrit, that doesn't mean that we will know what is Vedanta or what is Bhagavad Gita. And therefore, it is essential that we are very clear about every formula that is used, every term that is indicating something or the other specifically. Like in today's language, the common example, the cursor. Now the meaning of a cursor in language and in the computer is totally different, isn't it? In English, the cursor is not a good word. And in your computers, without cursor, you cannot move. See? Therefore, when we are studying Bhagavad Gita as a book of science, wherein it is clearly spelled out, what is a scientific method by which we can make use of the best that is available to us but not known to us? See, if we take the history of computers, I had a fortune of being with computers for many years. The first generation, there used to be a huge building and the data used to be fed by the cards. There used to be the punching machines, and the people have to lift huge quantity of the paper, the cards, and then it is punched, and then that punch data, then that is fed. See, we started from there, and now it has come to such an extent, and this growth is called as the scientific advancement. Meaning, more information is contained in lesser space and lesser time. Be very attentive. Scientific advancement means utilization of the time and space more economically and increasing the speed of life. This is called as scientific. So earlier, if somebody is to take 1 month to get a letter, then it became the postal mail. Then it became the wireless. Then it became the phones. And then still it grew. It became email. When the email came, the earlier mail is called as snail mail. And I don't know whether you know or not, but latest is now the smail mail. You can send as an attachment the dirty smell of your body to your beloved. Isn't it? Oh, science is advancing. And all this is contained in the language which has to be known by us. Only knowing alphabets, only knowing English is not enough. In the same manner, this total universe, the total field of experience is contained in such small, tiny terms that we will miss it. MC square. Now that MC square, what is that? But it contains the whole thing put together. See? So, when we talk of the world, the creation in science, we talk in terms of the three parameters: the time, the space, objects, and their interaction. Now, if we are able to manipulate these three, out of these three, two. When you can manipulate time and space, you can manipulate the objects. Out of the time and space, if you can manipulate the time, you can manipulate the space. And you go one step further. You enter the metaphysical area of investigation. Physics has its limitation. From objects to time to space. Thereafter, physics ends. And friends, what matters in life is not matter. What matters in life is the consciousness. See? In only matter, there is no problem. See the five great elements: Mahabhutanyahankaraha Buddhiravyaktamevacha. We'll come across that. In only matter, there is no problem. In pure consciousness, there is no problem. See? The problem begins when matter and consciousness are joined together by a bridge called as the mind. And therefore, the quality of the mind determines the quality of the experience. It doesn't matter what matter you are with. What matters is what quality of mind you have, so that the matter doesn't matter you. See? You must have seen and come across, there are people with all prosperity and they are prosperous, frustrated people. Go to the overdeveloped countries. They have got tremendous prosperity, all luxuries, and they are luxuriously miserable. One extreme. Another extreme, there are poor people and they are miserable in the poverty. Meaning, to be miserable, it doesn't matter whether you have prosperity or you have poverty. And the other thing also true. There are people who are tremendous rich and extremely happy. And there are people who have nothing and yet they are happy. Meaning, what matters in life is not what you have. What matters in life is what you are in what you have. So, our Bhagavad Gita takes us from the field of experience to the experience, and from the experience to the experiencer, and from the experiencer to the one which is beyond all the three. These are the four stages through which this knowledge is slowly presented to us in the present chapter 13th that we will be studying. So there are four stages. Stage number one, we get lost in the worldly objects. The field of experience becomes the primary concern for the science, the material science. So what is the most prosperous and the richest imagination? To have my house on moon. And then what will happen? I will invite people. Who will go there? Only moony people will go there. Living such a beautiful planet that the earth is. So our attention is only on the matter outside. First stage. Second stage is attention on the experience that we have. Okay. The other day I was in some other country, very beautiful. And when we are going, Swamiji, isn't it so beautiful? I said, yes, it is so beautiful. You have been trotting around the world. Tell me, which is the best place you like? I said, if I tell you, you will not like it. No, please tell. I said, the best place is your own heart. Go to the east or go to the west. Your heart is the best. Is it not? When you are in the luxuries of the Western world, there also we are dying to sleep. And when you are in the competition of the East or the Asian countries, there also we are dying to sleep. Once we enter sleep, how does it matter whether you are on the bed or the bed is on you? Makes no difference. So, first is the field of matter where we exist. Second is the experience that we have. Now the third place where we get lost is the experiencer that is born out of every experience. So something is according to my choice. I'm so happy. This is the thing worth observing in this world. See these tennis players or these cricketers. Where it is tennis player? I have done it. Where it is the cricketers? Dumbo? Isn't it? And if the shot goes wrong, if the catch drops. So I have done something or I have missed something. Three places. The field of experience, the experience and the experiencer. And these are the three areas where our whole life is shuttling from here to there, there to there, there to there. Like the people in Bombay. I take morning 7:32 Virar Church Gate. You know the highest happiness a Bombayan has to get entry in the train first. Second degree happiness. To get a place wherein you can hold something. The third stage of happiness. You get a place to stand near a seat. Fourth, you get a corner seat just to touch. Fifth, you get a seat nearer to the window. By the time you get a seat, your station comes. So we are constantly tossing between these three stations. And this is what is called as life scientifically. But our Gita tells, are you not bored of the same thing? Isn't there higher possibility? See, last time I told you, Human form is the form where nature has attained perfection. There is nothing more that nature can add in its own creation. She has exhausted all the possibilities of creating the best at the material level. She has exhausted the possibility. And if we have come to that end, see, and if we do not inaugurate some higher possibility in life, the next possibility is we revert back again from where we have started. See, this wheel I had told you last time, by God's grace, you must have forgotten. The plants eat from below and they grow upwards. The animals eat from the front, they grow backwards. Human beings eat from above, grow downwards. What is the next step? Eat from the backward, grow forward. That is all. So we have come to the height. So after having come to this position in life, if we are still happy only with the same thing, ahara nidra bhaya maitunancha, call this fellow Maikwala and his army. So if this is all that we can think of in life, that eat, be worried about the security, then sleep and procreate, for only occupations in the overdeveloped countries, nothing more. See, when you open a bud, you want to see what is inside, hurriedly, fast life. So you take that beautiful bud and start operating with your terrible nails. I want to see how it looks like. Forcibly, hurriedly opened bud is destroyed without maturing into fragrance and beauty. The same thing happens in life. When we are leading a very fast life, by the time a person is 20, he has lived the life of 80. And the remaining 80 years is not the life that is lived, but it is the burden of death that is carried on. See? And therefore, after having come to this stage as human beings, now to such mature students, Bhagavad Gita addresses in the 13th chapter. In the 12th chapter, the text told us that he who has the ability, the courage, the determination and the will to peep beyond the known frontiers of knowledge, to them only the highest is revealed. Those who do not have those guts, they will be all the time leading a life of frustration, depression, dependence, demands, dejection. Therefore, the beauty of such a grown, evolved individual is indicated. What was that? Advesta sarvabhutanam maitra karuna evacha. He who has, you know, the highest in the human evolution, sarvabhutanam advesta, he who does not carry an iota of hatred for anybody in the whole creation, even in a dream, even once, to that human being, the 13th chapter is addressed. Such great masters don't struggle to do good to the world. Goodness happens through them. Like the flower does not struggle to give fragrance to the world. The struggle is by those girls who are selling the perfumes in the duty-free shops. Catch hold of everybody, take little, just try this, this is very good. You know, 70% off. You take one and take the box free, but you take this, nobody is taking. It's not that. So, here the teacher tells us, he who has grown out of matter, and he who is the consciousness worthy, be very attentive. Unless the aeroplane becomes airworthy, it cannot take off. And what is the technique? When the aeroplane runs at tremendous speed, say 800 kilometers an hour, only for a very short period, maybe 2 miles, 1 mile, and in the tremendous speed, it becomes light. The moment it becomes light, it has become airworthy. In the same manner, by the process of contemplation, understanding, purity, sacrifice, dedication, commitment, when the load of matter is given up, then the life becomes light. And such light-hearted people are meditation worthy. To those students, this 13th chapter is addressed. See, Bhagavad Gita has got 18 chapters, 3 overs in the language of your cricket. 6 balls, 1 over. So there are 3 overs. And it is not only Bhagavad Gita's cricket, it is also a golf course. There are 18 holes, isn't it? So Bhagavad Gita is a holy book because there are holes in that. 18 holes. So, first 6 chapters have focus attention on the seeker. And what is the focusing attention on the seeker? Only one thing. Improve yourself. Improvement is not in terms of matter outside. Improvement is Yoginaha karma kurvanti sangam tyaktva atma shuddhaye. This is the principle. A seeker of truth, when he lives in this world, he is living in the outer world, but the purification is taking inside his heart. See, that is the purpose for the first 6 chapters. Like when we put the cloth in the washing machine, it is not for torturing the cloth. It is not for punishing the cloth. It is for making the cloth to be reused again in the same manner. The first 6 chapters tell us, man, don't run away from the challenges of life. Use this as an opportunity and purify yourself rather than running from one place to another place. Rather than running from one wife to another, one husband to another husband. The other day somebody introduced me. Swamiji, this is my dharma patni. I said, where is your adharma patni? That also you introduced. There is nothing like dharma patni. There is only patni. So, everything that is provided to us in this world is only for one purpose. Utilize this opportunity and purify your mind. First. Now, second thing. How do we know that our mind is purified? the science of a purified mind is we want to know something higher in life. No more interested in the same wretched thing. And what is that higher? He is called as, in the normal language, as the principle of God who created this world. How this whole world is managed. He must be a great genius. Let me know who is he. So there is another dimension which is inaugurated in the life of a seeker when his heart becomes purified. And that inquiry about God is the second topic. Now the third stage, we have come in the 13th chapter. From 13th up to 18th chapter, the last step. What is the last step? That seeker who lived a proper life by which he has become purified and now seeking about the God comes to discover that essentially he is the divine principle. He is not a wretched, miserable individual as he was thinking himself to be. So the last step in this scientific approach is only one. What is that? Discover your correct identity. All problems in life, they are born only out of identity crisis. There is no other problem. See? Take for example our Bhagavad Gita. First chapter. Most of you have heard. It was never a problem for Arjun to fight a war. That was his profession. It is something like Sachin Tendulkar going for batting. He has done nothing except hitting the balls. Isn't it? That is his job. In the same manner, such a great warrior as Arjun was, the moment he goes on the battlefield, suddenly there is a crisis about his own identity. Who am I at this moment? Whether I am a warrior or I am a grandson or I am a disciple to my guru. And the moment this problem cropped up in his mind about his own identity as to who am I, and with this doubt, suspicion, confusion about one's own identity, the whole life becomes a mess. All our strength, our ability, our wisdom, our knowledge, everything becomes totally unavailable. Therefore, we all are miserable only because of this identity crisis. Discover your identity. And you come to know that you are the source of all bliss. Instead of discovering the source of bliss that you are, you run away in this world and collect blisters and then start condemning the world. Oh, the world is too horrible. See, Maharaj. And therefore, these 13 chapters onward, the teacher tells us, Arjun, stop looking outside. Stop blaming others. Stop searching with the known means of knowledge. Inaugurate a new dimension in your life. Re-evaluate your own past experiences and judge what we have really achieved till date. If we are sincere to this inquiry, we'll come to know. If we were not in this world, there was nothing lacking. And when we will leave this world, there will be nothing lacking. Therefore, our presence is meaningless. There is something higher in this world. And unless we discover that highest, there will be no peace, there will be no fulfillment, there will be no contentment. And therefore, this last aspect of inquiry in the scientific approach to life begins from the 13th chapter. Now, this is the chapter where there is one verse which does not appear in the original Mahabharata. This is attributed to one great saint, Madhusudan Saraswati ji. On this verse, there is no commentary of Shankaracharya or anybody. However, it helps us to understand the synopsis of this chapter. So, Arjun says, Prakritim Purusham Chaiva Kshetram Kshetradnameva Cha Etad Veditum Icchami Jnanam Jnanam Cha Keshava. This will not be there in your book. Don't struggle. Where it has gone, where it has gone. It is not there. So, there are three inquiries. Now see how scientific it is. First, Hey Keshava, O source of knowledge and wisdom. What is that? I desire to know. See, unless we have that longing to know, we will never be steady on the spiritual path. Many people have got this problem. Swamiji, you know, sometime, you know, we are all right, you know, but then again our, you know, we are all gone, and again we come back to the same thing, and again we get, you know, in a good mood. I don't know what is happening. This happens only because there is no real hunger. Our study of scriptures and study of James Hadley Chase has a different quality. See, when we study James Hadley Chase, for what? For killing the time. But in the process, we get killed. Isn't it? But when we study Bhagavad Gita, it is not for killing the time. It is for killing yourself. Very important. So he asks, I desire to know. And unless we have desire, nobody can teach us. Therefore, this principle I explained to you. Whenever you think of Guru, don't have the wrong translation of the most famous verse. Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Devo Maheshwaraha, Guru Sakshat Parabrahma, Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha. Guru is Brahma, Guru is Vishnu. No, no, no. It is the other way around. Brahmaji is your Guru, Vishnu is your Guru, Maheshwara is your Guru, Parabrahma, Paramatma is your Guru, and that Guru is your own self. Look within, not without. See? Very, very important. So, with that intense longing to know the truth, Arjuna's question is, I desire to know what? Prakritim Purusham Chaiva. What is the meaning of matter and consciousness? How important it is. What is important in that? Actually, important thing is which share I should invest. That is important. Isn't it? What is important for us? That alone will take us on this path. So I want to know what is consciousness and what is matter. You know what happens, those who do not have that intense longing to know the truth. Sometimes such people come and ask us questions. So wonderful it is. Swamiji, suppose I am Brahman. I agree with you. So what? I said, you know, your statement is like what? You went to a cooking class and you were told how to make rasgulla. And the recipe is given to you, everything is given to you. And you read then. First of all, take nice milk and spoil it. And then do that. Now suppose we eat rasgulla, then what? If you eat rasgulla, you will not ask this question. In the same manner, when you discover what consciousness is, thereafter you stop living the miserable existence of a perishing body. You stop living the hungry existence of the Kriya Shakti, the Prana Shakti, the vital layer. Thereafter, you stop living the miserable life of the moods of the mind. Thereafter, you stop living the life of an arrogant, successful man. Then you start living as consciousness through the body, as consciousness through the prana, as consciousness through the mind, and as consciousness without arrogance. That beauty cannot be spelt in words. It can be experienced. And that experience which can be spoken of is only a mental hallucination. Therefore, the wise people keep their mouth shut. That is the only way. So, O teacher, I desire to know, please tell me, what is consciousness and what is matter? Second thing, kshetram kshetrajnam eva cha. We have also heard these terms. Sometimes they say kshetra, the field, and kshetrajnya, the knower of the field. So is it they are separate from each other, one and the same? Why different terms are used? Now the third thing, jnanam jneyam cha keshava. What is the meaning of knowledge? See? This is the most corrupted word that is used in a wrong manner. And when this is not known, we only use it in a wrong context and start cursing others. So what is the meaning of knowledge? What is the meaning of known or worthy of knowing? Oh Lord, I am very keen to know about it, kindly tell me. And in response to this inquiry, the teacher begins, Sri Bhagavan Vacha, Idam Shariram Kaunteya Kshetramitya Vidhiyate Etadyo Vetitam Prahuhu Kshetrajna Iti Tadvidaha. Now from here we enter the technical subject directly. First two verses of this 13th chapter. If we are able to digest, the remaining thing will be only the dessert. It won't be difficult. And to understand this, we have to be fully available. See, one of the most important spiritual practice is an ability to make ourselves available to whatever we do 100%. When we eat 100%. When we talk, we are full in that. When we listen, nothing else ever disturbs us. When we sleep, we can sleep even in the satsang. That ability to make ourselves available in any field that you take is the requirement in this science of life. See, please understand. To be a good doctor, you don't have to be a good person. See? To be a good engineer, you don't have to be a good person. To be a good politician, you have to be... I am not saying that. See? But when it comes to the spiritual science, there is no double standard. And therefore, to understand this, let us go deeper and deeper. Make yourself fully available. Now, first thing, Sri Bhagavan Vacha. See, the discoveries in the material sciences, the latest the discovery, the more authentic it is. All discoveries are discarded as redundant, and the latest discoveries are considered as more authentic. But it is the other way around on the spiritual path. See, the knowledge that we are talking about is not a created knowledge in time. It is eternal knowledge. And because of this, it cannot be a latest knowledge in spirituality. Therefore, please protect yourself from these gimmicks in the market. And why the people are showing the gimmicks? Because we are of that kind. See, we want shortcuts and get cut short in our life. Many people ask, Swamiji, do you have any shortcut method for meditation? Yes. Then what I should do? Go to the chemist, buy the sleeping pill bottle, biggest size, go to your room and empty the whole bottle inside, and thereafter you stop doing anything. You will be established in Nirvikalpa Samadhi. It will be a chemical meditation, irreversible. Please understand, don't go in for shortcuts in life. Never. Let the things open in the rhythm of life. And for that, we have to have patience. You know, the curse of the prosperity is a lack of patience. Remember earlier when the letters used to come, we used to wait. See, week I think I should get a letter. So you are ready to wait for 1 week. Now we click the mouse and your SMS delivered. But that fellow should open also. It may be delivered. And if you don't get immediately, Swamiji, I have sent you SMS, why are you not replying? If that is the only one I can reply. If you see my SMS list, you will be thrilled. No patience at all. So, here the teacher takes us step by step. First, this is not a created knowledge. It is not the latest. It is the most ancient one. And therefore, uncreated by the man's mind. It is uncreated knowledge. See, knowledge in our scriptures is divided under two levels. The authentic authority of the absolute knowledge is called as Shruti Grantha. This knowledge is revealed. And this knowledge is not about what is known by our faculties. Please understand this. Newtonananda Maharaj saw the apple falling down and gave the discourse that there is something called as the gravity force. That is not the knowledge accepted in the Vedas. The knowledge talks to us about that which is beyond the scope of our senses, our mind, our reason, our understanding. So, this cannot be a creation of the human mind. Therefore, it is eternally available knowledge, and that eternally available knowledge, when it is spoken of as an experience by a master like Bhagwan Sri Krishna, then it is transferred to us. That is the second stage. It is called as Smriti Grantha. So, Sri Bhagavan Vacha, the Lord Himself personified in this wisdom, living this wisdom every moment in life, is declaring this scientific truth for the total humanity to come. Nowhere in Bhagavad Gita it is mentioned. This is a holy book of Hindus. No. Science is not Western. Science is science. Isn't it? It's not in the Western world there is no sunrise. And in the Eastern world there is no sunset? No. So science transcends the barriers of any criteria. In the same manner, the knowledge given over here is meant for the human beings, whosoever you may be. So this Lord Sri Bhagavan Vacha declares, don't have the routine translations in your understanding. Sri Bhagavan Vacha, Bhagavan Bole. Now that is the limitation of the language, what can be done. So this is the truth declared by the eternity about the eternal reality. Now what he says? Idam shariram kaunteya, the first step. When we talk about this whole world, the other day one person asked me this question. Swamiji, according to you people, when is the world created? I said, according to we people, the world is not created. How come? So I asked him, when you snore away at night, and because of that, you have to sleep in the basement, and everybody sleep on the first floor. When you are snoring away, that time where the whole world goes? Think. One young boy asked me this question in Pilani. Very intelligent boy. Swamiji, what happens after death? I said, we'll dispose you off, we'll bury you, or we'll burn you, or we'll cut into pieces. No, not that way. Not me. I said, I am not going to die. Why should I die for your experiment? No, Swamiji, try to understand me. Understand. I said, okay, I'm understanding. Tell me. What happens after death? I said, to whom? Those who are alive, they are happy. No, you are not getting my question. I said, then you explain. What I mean, what happens when we die? See, clarity is not there. I asked him, I said, okay, I'll ask you a question. When you switch off a bulb, what happens to the light? Light is not there. I said, when you die, you are not there. So why worry about others? See? Very, very simple thing. So, who has created this? Where from the world has come? When the world was born? Are Maharaj, the world is created the moment we get identified with the body. The world begins not from the distant quarters. The world begins from your own gross body. Because this gross world is meaningful only when we are identified with the gross body, not otherwise. See? Very, very important. In the dream, we don't have this gross body in operation. And that time, we have a dream world. One person reported to the police station, sir, I have committed murder. I have killed my wife. So I have come to surrender. So the police says, foolish, when you have killed a wife, celebrate. Why surrender? No, I am a God-fearing person. Okay, how did you kill her? Where did you kill her? I killed her in the dream. So the police said, very good. but you have come to a wrong place. Go to a mental hospital, not here. So this waking world is meaningful only when we are identified with the gross body. See, this is the meaning of the waking world. And in this waking world, I want to win the election, and I will teach the world, and I want the, in the whole world, nobody should have any weapons of mass destruction, because I am enough. I can do it very effectively. Why others should have? I am ready to take the responsibility, how to destroy this world, isn't it? So this I, who is identified with the gross body, is the actor playing on the stage of this gross world. So the first thing to be known, idam shariram kaunteya. Now every word is a technical word, please understand this. If you take the example I gave you the other day, mouse. With the dictionary, if you take the mouse and want to operate the computer, you will never be able to do it. If you are a Ganesha Bhakta, then you will take and put some chandan and Jay Ganesha, Jay Ganesha. No. In the same manner, the word idam is a technical word. Idam in Sanskrit means this. But this is not only meaning. Idam means that which is recognized objectively is called as idam. Now see what is known objectively. When I look at my handkerchief, how do I look at it? This is an hanky, and I know this is a hanky, and I am not the hanky. How beautiful it is. Otherwise, what a fun it will be. Instead of hanky, put a donkey. This is a donkey, and I know this is a donkey, and I am the donkey? No. Now apply this knowledge. Don't we look at our body? Don't we know our body? But when it comes to the body, then I know this is the body, and I am the knower of the body, and I am the body. Very intelligent. Either you be the donkey, then we accept you to be the body. Or if you are not the donkey, you cannot be the body. This requires courage. This requires the readiness to change our own convictions. Friends, those who are neither ready nor able nor wanting to change our own convictions about ourselves, about the world, about the God, they are having blinkers on their eyes. They cannot go beyond that. And such crowds are tied together under the disguise of religion and sex, and the reins are the guilt and fear. If you do this, you shall go to hell. The other day I saw one young man, boy, putting a t-shirt, just back from hell, knows place. So because there are no place there, he has come back. So idam shariram, this whatever is known as objectively is not the subject. So the first principle is, whatever is known objectively cannot be the subject. For example, I know this mic. The mic doesn't know me. See, otherwise what will happen? I know this mic, and the mic also knows me. I know the other mic, this also mic knows me. I am not here. Then the mic will start talking to each other. But this doesn't happen. So the second principle is the object can never be the subject. Now third principle. Shariram. Normally we translate, you know what happens, you know, when we translate the original words in any other language, the beauty and the depth is lost. See? Like when you say to your wife in English, honey, I love you. So it is a traditional word you use, it's okay. But when you use a similar kind of word in translation, chewing gum, I love you, how horrible it looks. In the same manner, here, this word shariram, when you simply translate in body, the beauty is lost. What is the meaning of shariram? See, sharira means that which is subject to disintegration is called as shariram. Is it not? When the body dies, what happens? In fact, nothing happens. Because out of the five great elements, different combinations have produced this body. And when the life departs, what happens? First of all, the air goes and mixes with the total air. The heat goes and mixes with the total heat. And in this manner, the five great elements of whom this body was made, now they are slowly disintegrated and the body disappears. So that which is subject to disintegration is called as the body. Now be very attentive. Do we have the experience that I am disintegrated? We can never have that experience. So idam shariram kaunteya kshetramitya vidhiyate. Therefore, if we want to improve the world, if we want to think about the world, start thinking from your own body. Very simple. If you have got a very strong, healthy body, then you can do something in this world. That's why, you know, the only thing what we are trying to point out is that this body is subject to disintegration, it is subject to changes, it is born, it exists, it grows, it becomes old, it decays and it dies. These are the six modifications through which every body goes. So, idam shariram kaunteya. Now, another meaning, kshetram ityabhidhiyate. This is called as kshetram. Be very, very attentive. It's a very subtle topic. That which can be labeled by any name is called as an object. Be very, very attentive. When you look at a flower, we look at the flower as color, smell, touch, taste, sound. When we look at our eyes, when we look at our mind, and when we come to our own absolute self, there all these five differences disappear. So, abhidhiyate, it cannot be described in words. See, this is a very important topic. Whenever we want to talk about objective things, we can go on blabbering. And the moment we become more and more subjective, the language starts becoming staggering. And when we come to the absolute self, there is only one language, and the language of eloquent silence. Therefore, what is the meaning of the objective world? Objective world is that about which something can be spoken. And therefore, wise people, they keep their mouth shut. Because anything you talk about is a lie, total lie. The truth is that which is beyond the scope of speech. And therefore, the whole objective world has these characteristics. First, objects are many, subject is one. Second, objects are constantly changing, subject is never changing. Third, the object can never become a subject. Fourth, the validity of the object is dependent on the presence of the subject. Fifth, objects are constantly modifying, changing, but the subject is never changing, never modifying. And objects can be described through words. The subject can never be described through words. So, idam shariram kaunteya kshetramitya vidhiyate. Now see, for conducting the experiment in the spiritual science, you are the laboratory. You are the scientist. You are the guinea pig. You are the statistician. You are the one to conclude, and you are the one to evaluate, and you are the one to be benefited. It is not objective. Take Atma in one test tube and Paramatma in another test tube. And when you pour them together, there will be a different kind of color pattern. If it is red color, you are a Rajasic Atma. If it is a white color, you are a Sattvic Atma. It is all subjective. This is one of the reasons. The other day, somebody was telling me, Swamiji, you are explaining so many things. Why don't you, prepare some charts and I can work for you? I said, do you know that? Yes. I said, that is your problem. Therefore, you wanted some or the other to bring to that. Please remember, any support you take in talking about the reality, you are pushing the reality away. When it is said, even the words fail, do you think the forms will be appearing there? No. See, from the words we have to reach the source of the words. From the thoughts we have to reach to the source of the thoughts. From the experience we have to reach to the source of the experience, where all your material approaches are futile. Therefore, this is only possible through the Rutambhara Prajna, the subtle and extremely single-pointed understanding. This subtle and single-pointed understanding means what? We have got two types of understandings. First, we understand something which is known to us. Second, we understand something which is not known to us. So that area of knowledge which was unknown to us, when it is cognized by us, that faculty is called as the subtle faculty. And therefore, this is the first principle to be understood. Idam shariram kaunteya kshetramitya vidhiyate. Then, etadyo vetitam prahuhu kshetrajne iti tadvidaha. Now the second step. Tadvidaha, those who are the knowers of the kshetrajnya. So two things, this is a table and I know this is a table. So table, and I have become tablajnya. I am the knower of the table. In the same manner, this is the kshetra, the body with all the modifications, etc. And he who knows it is called as the kshetrajnya. Now be very attentive. This is where most of the people go wrong in understanding this verse. Most of them go wrong. It is something like, this is a glass, so I am the knower of the glass. Knower of the glass is not the glass. If this is true, What is our experience? I am the knower of this body and I am the body. This is our experience. Now out of these two, what is to be accepted? Tadvidaha. He or those who have understood the correct meaning of the knower. Yaha Veti, he who knows. Be very attentive. I know this. And I know. There is a difference in that. In knowing, when there is no objectivity, knowing and being is one. In knowing, when there is objectivity, the knowing and being is divided. Divided knowledge is mind. Undivided knowledge is consciousness. So, etadyo vetitam prahuhu kshetrajne iti tadvidaha. So, there are now three things we have seen. First, the body, the matter, all the qualities. It is born, it grows, it modifies, it dies. Then it is objective. It can never become the subject. And the one which is eliminating all the changes in the body is the kshetrajnya, the knower. Now the third step is this kshetrajnya, who is the knower, yaha vetti, he only knows. Means what? Now be attentive. The sound tuk 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 is coming, I know. Now there is no sound, even absence of the sound, I know. So who am I? Am I the knower with the conditioning of the sound? Or am I the knower without the conditioning of the sound? Or am I the knower irrespective of the sound? Three conditions. So this pure knowledge is not a qualified knowledge. Unqualified knowledge. So this body is the object, the knower of this is the subject, and this subject is other than the body. And therefore the purpose of this verse is not to discuss about the body. The purpose of the verse is to bring to our knowledge that which is enlivening the body, which is existing without the body, which is existing in the body, which is independent of the body. That reality is only to be known. It is not created. It is only being, not being born. After having told this, one more word the teacher uses, kshetra. What is the meaning of kshetra? The body is called as the field. Bhagavan Shankaracharya has given a very long detailed discussion. We will take only a short of it. See, kshetra means what? Where you sow the seeds and you reap the crop. This body is a vehicle given to us by the Lord. We use this body for something higher to be achieved in the human form, or we use this body and again go back to the same dirty corner where we began our life. So this is a vehicle which we can use to make our life or mar our life. Therefore, this is called as the kshetra. Second is, kshanat kshetra, Bhagavan Shankara says. Why this is called as the kshetra, the body? Because there is constantly leaking. See, the other day in our Delhi, I came from there last evening, I was there. And lot of huge crowd and all that. So many people taking prasad, khatkhatkar is moving. And there was one small, sweet little child. And so when the child came, I stopped. I took the child and hug and kiss and gave. देन द मदर ऑफ द चाइल्ड. स्वामी जी यू वॉन्ट किस मी? सो आई सेड ओके आई विल किस यू कम. देन आई पुट माई हैंकी बिटवीन हर चिक एंड माई माउथ. Why? I say, see how it is dirty, who will kiss? Swami ji, actually it was so much of rush and it was so much of, you know, heat and I was perspiring and therefore, you know, otherwise I don't sweat like that. Kshranat kshetra, constantly leaking. Isn't it? From this body, there is nothing which comes out as a matter worthy of discussion in public. Not dirt, dirt, dirt alone. But only for the sake of the body, on everybody, the whole life is spent. Like, you know, there are many these health conscious people, they are constantly after me. Swamiji, no, you should start doing some pranayam, you should start doing some, you know, Surya Namaskar, you should start doing this thing, that thing, then what will happen? Then you will remain healthy. Then what will happen? You will have a long life. Then what will happen? Population will grow. Please remember, don't desire for a long life. Desire for a lovely life, not long. You are not dying, what to do? Have the Japanese model, use and throw it away. Get out of this world. So this body is the one which is constantly leaking away. Why this is said? At least once in a while, if we get a disgust towards the body, then we can think of something higher. Otherwise, whole life goes only in that. Beauty parlors, yoga for beauty, yoga for reducing the weight. You know, the other day I was in South Africa. There, you know, they have started this fat removing operations. In USA, if you go to Tennessee state, like, you know, in USA, every state has got their own names, own logo, something like that. In Tennessee, I went. Such a huge elephants. I couldn't believe that these can be human beings. And the person, the doctor who was supposed to receive me, he did not come, his wife came. And after the evening, he said, Swamiji, I'm sorry I could not come, but there was an operation and it took a lot of time. I said, what operation? You are all healthy people here, what operation? He said, we are over healthy. Means what? He said, he told me the case. He said, I operated on a girl of 20 years from whom I have scooped out 22 pounds of fat. So she must be a mini elephant, isn't it? Huge one. So this body has nothing worth in it. Use it for something higher. For that purpose, this is called as kshetra. Now see, when I know that this is a tree or this is a plant or this is the road, I don't become the knower of that. I am not one with it. In the same manner, when I know the body, I cannot be the body. This is the principle. Then the question will come, then who am I? See? This is a very, very oft asked question. Swamiji, will you please tell me who am I? So what reply can you give? Full of the highest order. This who am I question becomes valid only when we have accepted ourselves to be somebody other than the body. Now see the tragedy. If you are other than the body, you can't be man, woman, you can't be born, you cannot die, you cannot have shape, you cannot have gender, you cannot have caste, color, creed, you cannot have religion, then who you are? Then that question becomes valid. Therefore, this first verse inaugurates a new dimension in the line of thinking. And how long are we going to keep after looking after the body whole life? And we all know none of the bodies ever live eternally. And we should thank God Otherwise, in the same old body we are living, throw it away, get a new one. And fortunately, we are Hindus. So don't worry. Mar gaye to mar gaye. Don't worry. Next life is there. And our God is very rich. 33 crore different types of dresses. And I want a buffalo. See, this is there. Go. Then you have lived through a buffalo life. Then I don't like that buffalo. No, I want to be like a camel. Okay, beta, go there. Rajasthan. Let us not have the poverty of life. Those who have got the poverty of life, they die in one life and never born again. We have got plenty of it. The idea is focus attention on something which never perishes. And what is that is the inquiry. Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnaat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Sri Guru Bhyo Namaha Harihi Om.